Long time ago, we didn't know that we were surrounded by other human beings. We knew we were surrounded by other tribes, other people who look like us. But we didn't know that there were other people across the big water, the ocean. Our grandmothers and our mothers, our fathers and our grandfathers, they learned this land. They learned the plants, which one would make you ill, which one would make you better. And as we go and our time gets closer and closer to what we know today, our world changes. Everything changes. The plants, the animals, the humans. That's these things that our grandmothers and our grandfathers tell us. They tell these stories, pass them on generation to generation, from Yayet to Mom to you.
So thinking back on the wars of 1858 that the Spokane tribe had, the Spokanes were considered a friendly group of people. Fur traders, even some gold seekers, if they stayed in line, they were botanists, biologists coming through, for them, unexplored country. They titled it that they had found it. Well, it wasn't lost. Tribes have been living here for thousands of years, generations, 100 generations.
I think people still have the image in their minds of the hostile, bloodthirsty, savage Indian, you know, going out to kill the poor settlers. And what people don't realize is that the settlers were in fact invaders. They were coming here with the help of the army, the missionaries oftentimes being complicit in facilitating that, taking away our lands, our ways of life, our religion, our spirituality, taking away everything. And these folks were really just trying to defend themselves. They were patriots who were defending their lands, their families, and their ways of life. In that instance, the United States was the aggressor. It was an invading power who took this place, this Spokane country, by military conquest.
So for the intruding white settlers, soldiers, people, they were coming in the terms, they called it manifest destiny, which meant to them, it is destiny that we take everybody's lands and make it our own. Tribes weren't quite aware of this yet. 1855 through 1858, the idea of pushing out the white people of our country so they didn't take it was in their minds.
The Army's presence grew in the Pacific Northwest really starting in 1855, when there was tension on the west side of Oregon Territory, as it was called at that time, and included Washington. Colonel Edward Steptoe was a Virginian, and came from an aristocratic family, and he bore himself as an aristocrat. He gathered 152 soldiers and another 7 officers or so, along with some packers and scouts, and they headed north.
They were coming to settle the unrest between Indians and miners up in the Colville Valley. They were also looking for a few tribal people that they suspected as stealing some cattle. If you look at their route that they marched, the trail that they followed wasn't in direct line to Colville. And if you lay it out on a map, you'll see that the military took a big wide berth under the Coeur d'Alene after they crossed the Palouse. Then they were heading straight towards what is now today Cheney. That land was our campsites where we gathered roots. At that time of year, it was a springtime gathering ground. there were some Palouse and Yakamas that were bringing the information back, spreading the word that the white soldiers were coming to kill. The sign that that was true was when Steptoe brought the cannon, the big gun, or for the tribes, they called it the gun that made two sounds.
This is a model 1841 Mountain Howitzer. It was designed to go where you couldn't take a full-size gun, and it was used from 1841 till about 1900. This was very popular out west because we could go anywhere with this cannon. We had two types of shells. The first was a very heavy, thick-walled shell, and then we had a lighter shell invented by a gentleman by the name of Shrapnel in England. And it had a lighter shell, filling it full of musket balls and then pouring in resin to make it all solid. Then he bored a hole into it, put the powder in there, and that's where the fuse went. And so now that shell would explode and send off all that little bits of thin-walled metal as well as the musket balls. It was much more effective. And we meant this to go off in front of you. This is moving about 1,000 feet a second, small explosive charge when the shell goes, and then it's gonna spread out so it's like firing a giant shotgun from that point.
He was pulling that. That was the sign of war. That was the sign to the Indians. The white soldiers came to fight. The Steptoe battle, he crossed the Snake, he crossed the Palouse and came up, headed straight for our root camps, and was stopped.
Steptoe took his men through that area. They were led by a Nez Perce scout named Timothy. There's some speculation that Timothy took them that direction on purpose because he wanted to irritate one of the Coeur d'Alene chiefs that he was having a feud with.
We united with the Coeur d'Alenes. We united with the Yakamas and the Palouse that came here to help drive them back. And it's not known who fired the first shot. But after the first gunshot went off, the horrors of war came to the Spokane tribe for the first time.
That day that those soldiers came, that day that those camps slept peacefully on their way to the brown camas fields, that day was the last day that they knew of true freedom and true peace.
It ended up that there was a group of chiefs, along with Father Josette, who were peaceful and didn't want to fight. They just wanted Steptoe to leave. Among them was Chief Gary, who had really lived in both worlds, as an Indian and with whites.
George Simpson comes through the Spokane territory, and he's trying to regularize the fur trade. He's in charge, and he doesn't see the fur trade as working all that well. He's not impressed by the efficiencies of the people who work for him. And he thinks, above all, it'd be good to have some cultural intermediaries, people who can have a foot in both worlds. The easiest way to do this seems to be to take some native youths. And he approaches the Nez Perce, he approaches the Kalispel, some other tribes, and he asks them if he can have some children to bring up to the Red River, where the main fur trading settlement is, and to educate them there. And Spokane Gary is carried off as a young boy there, and he's educated by the whites. He learns French, he learns English, he learns to read and write, and then he is brought back to his people.
So he went over there to the Red River Mission School in Winnipeg, Manitoba. He came back around 1830, 1831, thereabouts. And I think as a young person, he was fairly enthusiastic originally about sharing the knowledge or sharing what he learned at the mission with the people back here in the Spokane country.
The discussions by the chiefs, by both Coeur d'Alene and Spokane, we'll first go out and meet them in peace. By then, some of our tribal people could speak English fluently. Chief Gary is one of them. So it was a mix of war chiefs and peace chiefs that entered camp. And so then it was a little easier for us to understand or to take the position. It was time to defend our country, defend our families, to defend our way of life. So the battle was on.
Quite soon it became a running battle with everybody involved. And the Indians were running in circles, running through them in their horses. They were shooting their rifles, which they had, as well as bows and arrows.
The soldiers started to flee after they realized the wrongs that they had. They may not have realized what the Indians felt, which in history many times accounts for battles. The tribes thought they were going to attack their root village. The tribe saw the cannon. And so the battle wore on. It too was a type of running battle. Soldiers trying to move back south, back to Walla Walla, towards Nez Perce country with who their scouts were.
Eventually they ended up on a butte at the south end of the present town of Rosalia. His men kind of hunkered down. They took their pack animals and they put them in the center of what ended up to be a circle. On the outside of the circle were soldiers. They piled up boxes and bags of supplies about 2 feet high, and then they laid down and just watched the Indians around them just screaming and whooping and shooting, and they were all terrified. They several of them wrote later that they just knew they were dying. It was kind of the end of everything.
Night came, and it's told that Qualchin and Kamiakin wanted to continue the attack into the night, but others said to halt, and they would finish the fight in the morning. Well, the soldiers, they could hear in the background from far away the chants and the yells and the songs of the tribes that were in attendance. The story goes that Father Josette, of the Catholic priest of the Coeur d'Alenes, influenced a portion of the Coeur d'Alenes to open up a path for them to get out. And if you go to that site, there's a trail that drops off of that outcropping that made a path for the soldiers to get away, fairly concealed, because the tribes are singing their songs and making them, not sure if there were drums, but there was a lot of noise and excitement that goes along with a battle like that. So Steptoe got away, snuck out, or was let out, and that was in May.
That left the Indians really angry that he had done that to begin with, and it really incensed the army all the way up to President Buchanan. And that is what led the president and ultimately General Clark to send George Wright on his way to suppress the tribes.
That general is the one that said, you have to punish. Don't try to treaty. Don't try to talk. Go and make an example out of those Indians in the Northwest.
Colonel Wright put together his army at Fort Walla Walla, and they started marching in early August, and he embarked with 580 fighting men and about 200 more packers, civilian workers, and about 30 Nez Perce warriors and chiefs who were fighting on behalf of the army.
In the Wright campaign, he came back with the intent of destroying and destruction of all he could find or see. Battles took place again. The big difference, and even by their own writings and recollections, is that it'd be a completely different outcome if it wasn't for the new upgrade in weapons.
Military firearms, the United States military, prior to the Civil War, specifically 1857, 1858 timeline, the standard issue weapon prior to that was the model 1842 Springfield musket. And this is a musket, meaning it's a smoothbore weapon. Basically, it's like a modern shotgun. You would take a cartridge containing a round lead ball, and when that fired, it, as it travels down the barrel, it tends to bounce around because there's no rifling, there's nothing to make it accurate. Whichever way it bounced last is the direction it's going to go as it comes out the barrel. So it made the weapon relatively inaccurate. You couldn't expect to really hit a man-sized target at anything past 50 yards, and the weapon couldn't even really kill past 100 yards. Just didn't have the velocity. In 1855, the U.S. Army introduced a new weapon called the rifle musket, which is to take the same style of weapon but rifle the barrel. So basically the difference between if you were to throw a basketball versus throwing a football. With a football, you get a nice spiral. It's a far more accurate projectile. And what you get was this weapon here. This is actually the 1861 version, but it's the same kind of weapon as the 1855 Springfield, in that because of the rifling, you have far more accurate weapon with far more velocity. This weapon, the average soldier could hit a man-sized target at 300 yards, and the weapon could kill at 900 yards. When they invented the rifle musket, they also invented something called the mini ball, which is the first time they had a conical bullet. and the base of the bullet was hollow, so the bullet could be smaller so it could slide down the barrel, but when the powder ignited, it expanded the back of the barrel, gripped the rifling. So now you had a weapon that you could fire with the same rate of fire that you could a smoothbore weapon, but had the accuracy of a rifle. Now the Army can effectively start engaging targets at 300 yards. And if, when you can slaughter someone at 300 yards, somebody who just has short-range weapons has no chance against you.
So the firepower changed everything. So they could stand on the hilltop and shoot down or shoot across the plain at the tribes, and we couldn't get close enough with our bows, arrows, and muskets. The tribes started by using four lakes and the hilltop surrounding.
On the night of August 31st, they made their camp, and Wright ordered his men to prepare for battle because they could see to the east, maybe a mile or two, they could see warriors gathering on a hilltop.
First battle, many died. There's no account of how many, but with just such overpowering weaponry, the losses were substantial. We might not like to say it, but it had to be in order for the tribes to not want to continue for too long after the first two battles.
Wright sent his men out in two forces. One was a force of dragoons. Those were the professional soldiers on horseback, and very skilled at hand-to-hand fighting and firing. They were able to stay in their ranks, take their time, aim their new rifles, and use them with deadly accuracy. It was just one devastating volley after another. Combined with the howitzer fire, the Indians were ultimately just started to flee as the day went on.
And so the Four Lakes battle was over. Wright went back to camp. The tribes recollected. So Wright took time off to let his horses and men rest, because it was a tough battle for both sides. But he began the burning of villages, burning of caches of grains and crops and wheat and roots and berries and salmon, all that he could find. Because he figured if he couldn't find them to kill them, he could starve them. And so the outcome of the Four Lakes battle went much differently.
The Battle of Four Lakes was on September 1st, and then they rested for a few days and then started to move further north. And they knew that the warriors were regrouping. They'd seen them around, and they suspected that they were in for another fight. They formed a column with some dragoons and infantry in the front and at the rear, and then the supply train in the middle, because they figured that the Indians would try to go after the supply train. And they started marching north, and it wasn't long before they were attacked by warriors from three sides. And soon the Indians fired a wide swath of grass that, being September, it was very dry, and it quickly ballooned into a huge smoke cloud.
The tribes lit the ground to fire, trying to burn up, scare the horses, scare the mules, disrupt the pack trains. That might have had a better chance if not for the Mexican mule skinners. They were probably as much be given credit for not scattering the herd, not scattering 200 pack mules, scattering all the extra horses. But they were in tune with the animals. The Mexicans helped as much in that battle as anyone else.
The Battle of Four Lakes and the Battle of Spokane Plains were really just two violent depictions of what Wright intended to do. But the real damage came after that. There's a term that I think fits with Wright's campaign, and that is cultural genocide. It's where the people are not physically killed, but they're separated from their culture, spiritually, sometimes physically, but certainly emotionally.
Our people met again on a battlefield. And again, our people lay in the grass. Our people lay there with eyes not seeing in this world anymore. And it was our mothers and our grandmothers who washed those bodies and got them ready to return to their ancestors. And it was our fathers and our grandfathers who sang those songs, who told those stories of how great they were in battle. And all of this world bore witness to what we lost. and watching everything that we had worked for. Food stores, village sites, being burned to the ground, destroyed, slaughtered. We cried again. A truly heartbreaking cry.
So the battle is over. Wright crosses where now is the Fairchild Air Force Base, across Airway Heights properties, and ends up on the Spokane River. And then he camps again from the September 5th to the 7th, again having to rest his horses and men. On the 7th, they pack up camp and they're going to move north, following the Spokane River, seeing the Spokane Falls. In that area, there were a lot of tribal bands and camps because that was a major fishing site. Spokane Falls was historically well populated and well known gathering site for tribes in the region where thousands would come to get a share of the fish. Spokane's, because there had to be a lot of loss of life because of overpower weaponry, went to talk. Palotkin, who was a lower Spokane, his band came from around Fort Spokane. Chief Big Head, he was there. He sent his son in to speak for him. His son could speak English because he had went to Red River and learned with Gary.
They met with Chief Gary and Chief Palotkin of the Spokanes, and they told them to go tell their people to essentially remain peaceful.
What the history don't tell you is people were hung on the site, going into camp, thinking, okay, the war is over. It's time to talk peace. It's time to talk the next step. But when they arrived in camp, they were hung or they were shot. During that period of time, there was at least 27 tribal people that were hung in that fashion. Both sides account that most of those warriors didn't wait. They didn't give the satisfaction to the hangman of taking his life.
When Wright hangs the men, he's committing what's basically a war crime. He's not going by his own rules. His men are uncomfortable with it. You can see it kind of in some of the conversations that happen later and the ways that Wright justify it. You're not supposed to execute people who've come into your camp. Wright doesn't live to see service in the Civil War, but many of the men who were with him did. Just a couple years later, America's in this vast, bloody struggle. And you can find very few instances of anybody, Union or Confederate, doing what Wright did that day. He takes these men and he murders them. We shouldn't be afraid to use that word.
So they're going to continue their march towards Cataldo, where they knew the Coeur d'Alenes were, and Father Josette had gathered some of the Coeur d'Alenes. After talking to the Spokanes, they kept that march. And all across that prairie between Spokane and what is now the city of Coeur d'Alene, they were burning villages and they were burning caches of wheat. They were killing cattle. By that time, tribal people had already become agriculturalists. They already knew they could grow grains. They learned that. They were starting cattle herds. They were starting major herd horses.
Along the way, they saw a big dust cloud in the hills south of the river and sent some men up to investigate, and they saw a huge herd of horses, and they managed to gather 900 or 1,000 of them, numbers vary, and they drove them down to a place along the Spokane River.
But in that 900, they picked out 130 of what the military thought were the best horses. Some of them were probably some of the horses taken from Steptoe, but they picked out the best. Of those 130, they quickly realized that the relationship between the tribal person and his horse runs deep, and that as soon as the horses realized they were trying to be taken from their owner, they would jerk loose off of the picket line, or they would jerk loose trying to get back home to their owner. And so those 130 horses never made it back because as they were escaping, they too were shot.
Our four-legged brothers that we loved and cared for the same as we would our children and our parents and our grandparents, he rounded them up and he put them in a corral, and one by one he led them down to the creek. And the young ones he bashed their heads in. The old ones, he put a bullet in their head.
There were witnesses of our people who watched and listened. And first they shot the horses. And then they said, well, it's taking too much ammunition, so they just start beating them to death, pretty much.
And when that wasn't fast enough, he pulled in his soldiers and he gave them free rein on those helpless horses in that corral, and he opened fire. The last vestiges of our freedom gone. That was the last testament of the cruelty that was being enacted on each other from human beings.
The witnesses said, when the mares were getting slaughtered, and when the colts were getting slaughtered, they said the colts sounded like babies crying. And the mares were crying out like mothers crying out for their children. And the studs, the male horses, were crying out loud like they were angry.
At that point, there started to become a belief that this George Wright was not your average kind of white man. This man was willing to do anything to accomplish his means. And it was kind of almost like he intentionally did it as a theatrical event. And they knew that Indians were watching. And one of the officers later wrote, nothing we did on the march harmed the Indians more than killing those horses.
And so in the history books, it says that the killing the horses took the heart out of our people to fight. That's the history book. They defeated us. That's the history book. What I was told and what I was experienced and through the stories, that the people came together and they said, what manner of man would do this to the four-legged? And I was also told from my Coeur d'Alene relatives that what manner of man would kill our family in this way. So from my background, from my history, it was this man wasn't worth fighting because he had no compassion for life. So to do an honorable thing, because in battle, and this is from my father's side, on the Ho-Chunk side, there is honor in battle. You just don't go out and fight. You go out and you protect your people, you protect your way of life. And how well you do and how strong you stand up, that's an honor.
It was mid-September, and he was running low on food. His men were unsure about what was going to happen next, even though they had won the victories and they felt like they were superior to the tribes. Now they were still heading east, and they were heading into the fall, and they didn't know what was going to happen. And I believe that his force would have been in a lot of trouble if not for the help of Father Joseph Josette from the Coeur d'Alene Mission up in Cataldo, which is about the middle of the Idaho panhandle using present-day boundaries.
They talked of a peace treaty, not a treaty as in fishing rights and hunting rights and going to a reservation. The peace treaty that was signed just talks about the Coeur d'Alene's not ever going to war again. Wright wanted to protect the Nez Perce from the Coeur d'Alene's ever retaliating against them. So they made them, in that treaty, made them promise that the Coeur d'Alene's and the Nez Perce would forever be friends, friendly towards each other. So after he left Cataldo and started his march back towards Walla Walla, there was a trail, an old Indian trail that went through the Coeur d'Alene's land, crossing the prairies and crossed a creek. They called it Leta because there was a farmer in that area with the last name of Leta. Josette helped gather the Spokanes in that creek draw, that drainage.
When we reached that final spot, and we were told that we would be treated with kindness if we laid down our weapons And we came peacefully and we surrendered everything we knew and everything that we loved and everything that we held sacred. If we surrendered it at the feet of Colonel Wright, we would at least remain human beings in his eyes. And he lied. He lied to us. We were bad children who needed to be taught a lesson in the worst possible way.
Josette had a few of them there waiting for Wright's military force to come back. He was still looking for some of the people he considered the war leaders, Alhai and Qualchin and Shroom and Kamayakin. So when he come into camp and he set it up and he sent Gary out, Chief Gary came in to talk, told him to go find Qualchin and Kamayakin and tell him to come back. He had sent word to Gary because he had already captured Alhai. Alhai come in to talk peace, but he was taken prisoner and he was put in shackles. And so he was kept in a tent. Alhai was getting pretty up there in age by then, and he was treated pretty cruelly. He told Gary to go tell Qualchin, if you do not come in, I'll hang your father on the site. The next morning, the story is told that four people came riding into camp. It was Qualchin and his wife, who was Palotkin's daughter, his brother, and one of their other warriors that was with them. And within, some accounts say 5 minutes, others say 15, a rope was put around his neck and he was pulled up on a tree and hung. That creek later became known as Hangman Creek because of the incidents there. Other accounts of six warriors being hung. There's another account where three warriors specifically were hung.
Those guys were those ones to be hung. They were asked one at a time, anything you'd like to say, and they went down the line.
That it was attempting to get the warriors to beg for their life. You know, get them to succumb to the fear of death. And so when it was asked of the first man, he stood up straight. Second man. And they came to this man, and he looked out at the people that were there to witness this, and it was tribal people, our people. And he looked at the one who asked the question, the authority figure, and he did not have the hate, he did not have any of that, didn't have the fear. And he looked at each of the men that were going to be executed with him. And in his language, in our language, he said, yes, I do. And the other ones, they turned to him like, no, don't. And he looked at them, and then he looked at the people. And then he said, I have a song that I'm going to sing and offer it to you, so you will remember this day, always and forever. And what's done here. At this point in life, when their life was going to be taken away, he didn't think of himself. He thought of the future generations. Not to remember this day and be angry at the white man. Not to remember this day and be pitiful. Not to remember this day and be fearful. But no, remember this day. Because through the song, you know we have the strength and the faith and the power to continue on. Because we will live. Remember this song and hear this song generation upon generation upon generation. And the beauty of that, there were no recordings, there was no written music, it was sung. And it was remembered. Just as we do today, we sing that song. Flag was raised. That's Spokane, that's who we are. We're powerful people. And that's one of the many, many gifts that we've received that allow us to remember that and acknowledge that and be that.
This is what we remember. This is the story of our people. But the moon is rising. And I think it's time that we lay those ghosts to rest for tonight. And I know what I told you was hard. I know what I told you was ugly and hurtful. That what I say is not to hurt your feelings. What I say is so that you understand why you need to be so proud of who you are. Why you need to always stand with your head held high. Why you need to always walk with grace and with beauty. What I tell you is so that you understand why they gave everything they had so that one day you could walk this earth, you could tell this story, you could carry on what they thought they were losing. Because we didn't die. We're still here. We're still living and breathing and we're still proud. And we're still doing everything we can to remember who we were and to look to see who we're going to be. It's in the past. It can't be changed. But the future is what can change. You have that here in your heart. Here now? Here now. Sayu hoi. Lem lem spetsia.